Welcome to Pedo Teeth Talk, brought to you by the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, a podcast show that delivers cutting-edge ideas for the professionals specializing in pediatric dentistry.
Thank you for tuning into Pedo Teeth Talk, where we bring you the contemporary issues important to you and your practice. Brought to you by the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry. I am your host, Joel Berg. Thank you to our Pedo Teeth Talk sponsor, Hugh Freedy, for helping us bring you great content. We couldn't do this without them. Visit them at www.hughfriedy.com. That's H-U-F-R-I-E-D-Y.com. We're here today with Dr. Juan Fernando Yepes to talk about screening for common and not-so-common oral lesions. Dr. Juan Yepes is a professor in the Department of Pediatric Dentistry at Indiana University School of Dentistry and an attending at Riley Children's Hospital in Indianapolis, Indiana. He's also an adjunct professor at the University of Buffalo School of Dental Medicine, Department of Pediatric and Community Dentistry. Dr. Yepes is a dentist and also a physician from Xavier University, where he graduated in Bogota, Colombia. In 1999, he moved to the U.S. and attended the University of Iowa and the University of Pennsylvania, where he completed a fellowship and residency in radiology and oral medicine, respectively, in 2002 and 2004. In 2006, Dr. Yepes completed a Master in Public Health, MPH, and in 2011, a doctoral degree in public health, Doctor of Public Health, both of which emphasized epidemiology and were done at the University of Kentucky College of Public Health. In 2008, he completed a residency program in dental public health at Texas A&M University College of Dentistry. And finally, Dr. Yepes completed a residency program and master's degree in pediatric dentistry at the University of Kentucky in 2012. Dr. Yepes is triple boarded by the American Boards of Pediatric Dentistry, Oral Medicine, and Dental Public Health. He is an active member of the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, the American Academy of Oral Medicine, the American Academy of Oral and Maxillofacial Radiology, the Indiana Dental Association, where he's a member, and is a member of the American Dental Association. He's a fellow in dental surgery from the Royal College of Surgeons in Edinburgh. And he is a member of the Editorial Board of Oral Surgery, Oral Medicine, Oral Pathology, and Oral Radiology. It used to be called Triple O. I guess it's beyond that now. And Dr. Yepes, thank you so much. We couldn't have a better expert on the subject that everybody's been asking for, especially right now. So thank you so much for being with us today.
Well, Dr. Berg, this is like finally a dream is finally a reality. I was waiting for this invitation for a long time, honestly. And this is a great honor to be here today. And it's a great honor to be talking with you. So thank you to the Academy and thank you to the sponsor. I'm extremely happy to be here.
Well, it's mutual because the audience has been waiting to hear you, so it's a perfect fit. So let's get going. When I talk to you about doing this, obviously we can't give a compendium of oral pathology and oral medicine in a short podcast. However, I think you agreed that we could talk about the methodology that you give to your students and to us in this case about how to go about a process in our dental practices of assessing the situation to look for these issues. So can you start out maybe by just telling us what are the three, four, or five most common lesions that a pediatric dentist would encounter in their daily practice?
So, Dr. Berg, before we go into the three or five most common lesions, let me I just step back and make sure that we are all walking through the first step, which is a pretty detailed oral exam. Working with children sometimes is a challenge. We have a moving target, but nevertheless, and no excuse, honestly, either we need to do a lab-to-lab exam or we do the exam in the regular chair. But I think so the first step is always to complete, as much as we can, a detailed oral exam of the oral cavity. Well, oral exam of the oral cavity, sorry for... Then after we do that, we don't have microscope in our eyes. I wish we have a microscope that we can look at the lesion, and then the microscope will tell us, no worries, this is a mucosal, or no worries, this is a fibroma. So we basically, we need to be a good clinicians. That means that using our eyes, using the location of the lesion, using the symptoms, using the time that the lesion has been present, using all these elements, we come with a differential diagnosis. And again, I want to make emphasis that we don't have a microscope, but after we do a good exam, we put together all the elements, and then we go straight into a differential diagnosis. And the differential diagnosis need to be as close as we can to the final lesion. So now, jumping into your question, As a pediatric dentist or dentist who like to work with children, by far, probably canker sores or recurrent aphthous stomatitis is by far probably the number one lesion that you are going to see in a busy dental practice. After the canker sores or the recurrent aphthous stomatitis, I will include in the five top list papillomas, mucoceles, and then in the last group, I will place fibromas or irritational fibromas together with pyogenic granuloma, and the other two that together they are probably, you remember from your days in dental school, the three P's, which is pyogenic granuloma, peripheral ossifying fibroma, and peripheral giant cell granuloma. So that will be my top five. But by far, canker sores number one.
That's fantastic. And I love that you list that. I'm going to ask you about your process here throughout a lot of this talk today. It's interesting you listed those. I practiced yesterday and I saw two of those. Of course, I can't be sure because my eyes aren't a microscope, as you said, but I'm using your advice. I used your advice and thought the location and prevalence and appearance, those kind of things. So let's move on to your, I think it's a famous thing. We're going to make it famous. The five Yepes steps. Dr. Yepes' steps in differential diagnosis. If I see something, what does it mean?
Okay, so let's talk about canker sores. That's by far the most common soft tissue lesion that we are going to see in a busy practice. But imagine that we don't know if it's canker sores. We have a new patient coming to our office. The patient is a teenager, and the patient is coming from a new patient exam. You actually do a good interview with the patient, with the parents, and then it's time to look at the mouth, and then you see a sore. So when you see the sore, that's the time that you are going to apply what I call the five Yepes steps. Dr. Berg, they are not really my steps, believe me. I learned that from all the amazing teachers that I have through my life. But I like to use the Yepes steps because that's a good way to remember for my residents, my students, and my colleagues. So these five Yepes steps is like almost like a systematic approach to that sore. So we have the teenager in the chair, and we are looking at the sore. So I will briefly, because we don't have a lot of time to go into the details, but let me tell you the five and how they help you. So the first one is the patient age. What I mean with that is not the same to have a sore in a teenager than to have a sore in a baby or to have a sore in a kindergarten. Generally speaking, and again, you know, patients, they don't, you know, the lesions, they are not books, but generally speaking, canker sores, which is again the most common, probably you are going to see that in teenagers. If you see the sore in a two-year-old, in my differential diagnosis, I will place canker sores maybe number three, number four. The next one is the medical history. That's my second step in the five Yepes steps. Why that is important? Because, as you know, Dr. Berg, very often medical conditions, they will give you sores in the mouth. Now, you don't need to do a full physical exam and a complete medical exam. We are not physicians. But we need to know as a dentist that there are some conditions that they will give you sores in the mouth. So when I'm teaching my students, my residents, Dr. Berg, about this, I tell, you just need to go and ask some quick questions. For example, I will tell you just one. It is a good way to illustrate the medical history. There is one condition that we call lupus. So lupus, and we have a patient recently here in the hospital, lupus will give you systemic issues. So lupus will give you lesions in your skin, will give you bleeding and other problems. So when I see the sore, and I'm not a physician, but I need to ask some questions about the general health to try to identify any health issues that can be connected with that sore. Now, one more example, Crohn's disease. Crohn's disease is a GI condition who also will give you sores in the mouth. So every single time that I have a patient with sores in the mouth, I ask, are you having some GI issues? I know, it's so superficial, but it helps you to kind of move away all the potential medical issues. So three more for the Yepes, five steps. The next one is, and I think so this is one of the keys, and we are dentists, so we can go through this, the history. How often are getting the sores? If this is the first sore, if the patient tells you, oh, I had this sore for the last 6 months, obviously that's not a canker sore. Canker sores, generally speaking, they are self-limited. They are usually for a couple of weeks. So you have a patient with a sore in the same place for the last 6 months, I will place canker sores as a little bit more number three, number four potential differential diagnosis. And to finish, the last two are family history. That's important to ask if mom and dad used to have the same sores in the mouth. You probably remember canker sores seems to be very hereditary. So mom and dad used to have the same when they used to be young. And finally, the one that I love it is my last five step is the clinical aspect. That's pure dentistry. That means where the sore is located, how the sore looks. Generally speaking, canker sores don't like to be present at the heavy keratinized mucosa. So Dr. Berg, if tomorrow you are in your practice and you have a teenager with a big sore and the sore is located at the hard palate, that's a heavy keratinized mucosa, I will, when I write my differential diagnosis in my electronic health records or in my paper chart, just because the location, I will write canker sores as number two or number three. No, for sure, as number one. I may well think about trauma or a different reason. So I know it's hard to remember.
Yeah, no, it's really, and that's why I'm attributing it to you. And whether it was before, we're heretofore calling this the five Yepes steps. So everybody's going to refer back to that. So I wanted to ask you about the aphthous sores the canker sores that we would see. And you talked about them being on less keratinized, less heavily keratinized, like the alveolar mucosa versus the attached gingiva. So, you know, back in my training, we would distinguish sometimes herpetic lesions from aphthous ulcers because the herpetic lesions do like to reside on the heavily keratinized tissues. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. When you ask me about the five, I probably will squeeze one more, which is herpes, especially in the pediatric population. That's a often confusion for the clinician between canker sores and herpes. Extraoral herpes, when you develop herpes labialis, you know, my mom is not a dentist, Dr. Berg, but if you have herpes labialis, my mom will tell you, you probably have herpes. I mean, that's so typical that people will know. That's a cold sore. But what happens is when you have herpes inside the mouth, the differential diagnosis is a little bit more challenged, especially between canker sores and herpes. So going back to your comment about when you were in dental school in your your residency program, herpes, number one, H. That's one of the five steps of Yepes differential diagnosis. Herpes is usually in young kids. Herpetic gingival stomatitis is usually between 2 or 3 years old. And intraoral herpes is usually young kids. That helps. And the second thing that helps, and it's also part of the five Yepes steps, Dr. Berg, is the location. Herpes loves to be at the marginal gingiva. That's the favorite location of herpes. Canker sores, they don't like to be there. So you have a child with sores, and herpes can give you sores in other places. I tell my residents and my colleagues, when you have a patient with sores in the mouth, the first place that you need to look is at the gums. Remember the five steps, the last one is location. If you see that the source of the erythema or the inflammation is located at the marginal gingiva, immediately you need to think about herpes as a potential differential diagnosis. We don't have microscopes. Again, we cannot smell. It's not like lesion smells herpes. But herpes loves to be at the gums. Canker sores loves to be away the gums. So that's a good point.
Got it. Makes sense. One last question quickly about aphthous, since you said it was at the top of the list overall or near the top for most ages. You know, you said it was self-limiting, and we all know that it is normally, you know, after 10 days or something, it goes away. But a lot of people, and I do this sometimes too, will offer as palliative treatment to treat it like an ulcer in the stomach. You know, where you might get some kind of topical like kaopectate, Pepto-Bismol dabbed on there just to kind of keep the air from getting on it. Do you have advice around this or just say, nah, leave it alone?
Dr. Berg, do you want to know something that is borderline funny?
I do.
Okay, let me tell you something. Every time that I talk about canker sores, during the break, when I go to the bathroom, somebody will run behind me to tell me, Dr. Yepes, you didn't talk about, and then you fill that with 150 different treatments for canker sores. It is it's borderline funny. People will tell me, I remember recently somebody told me, oh, I squeezed formocrisol over the sore. Ooh. So in a very practical for this podcast, so if you are, you know, our colleagues who are listening to the podcast, if they want to take something home, you know, the treatment of canker sores is almost like going through steps and going up stairs. So usually, 90% of the time, I don't offer any treatment except just reassurance that the lesion will disappear in a couple of weeks and just self-monitoring and make sure that the lesion disappears. Sometimes, if either this is a major canker sore, which is about 1 centimeter, or the patient is clearly complaining of pain, I offer topical treatment. In that range of options, topical treatment, there is a huge portfolio from, you know, canker melts, which is like a little thing that you put over the sore to cover the sore, to more sophisticated treatment, which is topical steroids. So, you know, at the end, Dr. Berg, the treatment is coming from how many they are, how painful they are, and how willing the parents are to jump and to follow the instructions, and how, because if you prescribe a gel, for example, a topical steroid, the parents will need to help you in how they apply the steroid because they need to put it in a gauze. They need to do that twice a day. So it need to be some, you know, compliance from the parents and how to apply. So, but again, generally speaking, I don't prescribe. Now, finally, before Dr. Berg, we're going to a different question. There is also step 3, step 4, step 5. Recently, here in the hospital, we have a patient with massive canker sores every single month. Nothing seems to help. So we ended up prescribing colchicine. And this podcast is not about colchicine. That's a medication used for gout, but it's an excellent anti-aphta medication. But just for the listeners, just to keep in mind that there is a step-by-step approach, and at least it's hope for the patients who seems not improving with just the typical topical treatment.
That's great. And now I won't be one of those people chasing you during the break because I already have the answer. We will now pause for a word from our sponsor.
Hugh Freedy is the global leader in dental instrument manufacturing, offering pediatric restorative solutions that keep you performing at your best. For more information on Hugh Freedy products, visit www.hughfreedy.com/AAPDcrowns.
We are back with Dr. Juan Yepes talking about his systematic approach for assessing common and not so common oral lesions. He's given us the 5 Yepes steps. And a question, Dr. Yepes, I want to ask you right away, it's on everybody's mind, is during this COVID-19 pandemic, you know, we see a lot in the lay press. Some of us have posted cases in different media talking about oral lesions that are associated with COVID-19 infection. Can you talk to us a little bit about that, please?
Dr. Berg, when I start to explore a little bit more in detail the oral lesions associated with the COVID, as you can imagine, you probably will do the same. I went through the web and I went to PubMed and I just typed COVID and oral lesions, and I got about 120 articles. The majority of the articles just case reports. So the reason that I'm starting to answer your question in this way is because there is a lot of case report outside with lesions all over the place, different aspects, different location, different presentations. And it doesn't seem to be very homogeneous. Like, not every single article will tell you, hey, look at the tongue, because it seems like the majority of the lesions are in the tongue. However, and that's probably the answer of your question, after doing this systematic review and looking at all the potential reports and putting together a PowerPoint, so I did a lot of research, and also I saw a few patients here in my hospital, it seems like there are 2 lesions that they may, and I need to be very careful with that, they may indicate that could be connected in the correct patient with COVID. That means, you know, in a patient that is positive for COVID, asymptomatic or symptomatic. So the 2 lesions are, number 1, the tongue. It seems to be one of the places that is a little bit consistent across the border. That means, in some reports, they call that a strawberry tongue. I honestly, the 2 patients that I saw with COVID and oral lesions, it was not the typical textbook strawberry tongue that it looked like a strawberry. It just looked like a few red dots at the dorsum of the tongue. And it may be in a few more days, in some patients, that few red dots in the tongue will develop into the strawberry tongue. That's the first one. And the second one is petechias. In about 25% of the case reports about oral lesions of COVID, the petechias are also reported in about 30 to 35% of the reports. These petechias are located in the soft palate, in the junction between the hard palate and the soft palate, that in no COVID times, so imagine a year ago when we were completely outside the COVID, the same lesion, in my mind, probably will be idiopathic thrombocytopenia. As you probably remember, Dr. Berg, when you have a low platelet count, when the platelet count drops below 40,000, you may start to develop a small petechias in your palate. The lesions of COVID looks exactly like that. And they are using a term, enantem, which is spelled E-N-A-N-T-H-E-M, enantem. I know with my Kentucky accent sometimes it's difficult. So enantem are small petechias. So these are the two places, the tongue and the junction between the hard palate and the soft palate.
Yeah, and we love your Kentucky accent, by the way. Yeah, those, you know, it's interesting. We're hearing a lot, and we're not going to talk about this today, but we know so little about COVID relative to what we're going to learn. But one of the things we keep hearing is that it's really actually a blood dyscrasia disease, and that might be connected with these petechiae, but we'll talk about that another time. I want to talk about, we talked about sores in the surface, and in the last segment, I want to talk about a couple other things. Bumps. You mentioned that mucocele is one of the common lesions. That's kind of a bump, but let's talk about common bumps, and when do you need to biopsy? You know, I saw a kid yesterday, and I was 100% certain this is a mucocele based on using the Yepes method. I decided it was a mucocele, but when do we need to biopsy, and when do we not need to think about it?
Dr. Berg, I start with answer that probably when you see a bump, the biopsy is almost mandatory. I would say that it's a good beginning when you, in your mind, you always assume that if you are in front of a bump in the aortic cavity of a child, at some point the next step will be a biopsy. So that will be usually my approach. Now, bumps in the lips, just using statistics, the problem is patients, they don't know that, so yes, statistics helps. The most common lesion is a mucocele, but not necessarily every single bump in the lower lip is a mucocele. Now, clinically, the mucocele will give you some features that they clearly will help you to point toward the diagnosis. Soft, fluctuant, painless. You can see that kind of crystal color, so you almost can see the mucus inside the lesion, but still, that lesion that is so classical mucocele, I probably will suggest to take a biopsy. Now, the next step, what else could be a bump? I mentioned when you asked me the 5 or the 6 more common lesions that you can see as a pediatric dentist. And then let me briefly go over the 3 P's, something that I learned a long time ago when I was in dental school and it's still helping me a lot when I see a child with a bump at the gum line. So when you see a child with a bump at the gum line and I want to move away the abscess secondary to a deep caries lesions, my mom can do that diagnosis when you see the abscess. So assuming there is no an abscess. The bump could be 3 things, and the only way to really know which one is taking a biopsy. Now, my recommendation when you see a bump located at the gum level, the next step is you tell your assistant, please, we are going to take a radiograph, and we hope to take just one, not 25 to get one, so we take a radiograph. And that's important because the radiograph and the radiographic findings can help you to do a provisional differential diagnosis before you refer or you decide to take a biopsy because maybe you are going to do that. So the 3 P's are, number 1, the pyogenic granuloma, which the name, as you remember, is not related with, is not pyogenic, so it's not an infection, and under the microscope is not a granuloma. It's just an exophytic, protuberant, hyperplastic, reactive lesion, usually reactive with a piece of popcorn or something in between the teeth that triggered that hyper response of the soft tissue. So that's pyogenic granuloma. And the other 2 are a little bit less common, the peripheral ossifying fibroma and the peripheral giant cell granuloma. They are a couple of features that can help me to do the differential diagnosis, but no question they all need a biopsy if we want to come with a final diagnosis.
That's fantastic. And by the way, I want to, since you mentioned radiograph, as a sneak preview to our listeners, we're going to get Dr. Yepes and his expertise back again really soon because, as you heard, he's a radiologist as well. And a lot of the assessment and the lumps and bumps and all of these things about common and not so common, we have to actually cover radiology. So we're going to do that next time, so stay tuned. So I want to get to our last question for today. I wish we had more time, but as I said, we're going to get you back probably more than once. And I think babies, you know, we talk about the age 1 dental visit. It's a focus. We interviewed our past president, Kevin Donnelly, recently about we need to bring back the age 1 dental visit. But even going back to before age 1, what about infants and, newborns and before age 1? So just very briefly as a point of closure today, what do we need to remember about oral lesions in babies? You know, everybody remembers Epstein's pearls and Bond's nodules and you know, that a very high percentage of kids has something going on in the mouth, usually innocuous. So tell us about a process for that, for looking at babies.
I always tell my residents, Dr. Berg, that at some point in life, the neighbor, you know, they know that you are a dentist. So at some point, they are not going to knock at the door of your home and with a little baby and say, hey, we know that you are a dentist. Could you please help us with this lesion or this little thing that appear in the mouth of our baby? So we need to be prepared for that. So good point. So just briefly, the majority of the pathology in babies is self-limited. It doesn't require any treatment. We need to take a biopsy. We don't need to take a biopsy. I will just mention briefly the palatal cyst of the newborn. Palatal cyst of the newborn. Again, sometimes with my accent sounds weird, which is a common lesion. As the name, probably the most common place is the palatal cyst of the newborn. The name is in the palate. Depending on the location, if you remember, they are denominated by under two different names. Epstein-Barr, which they are usually two or three little white, almost like a mini golf balls located at the hard palate, that's the Epstein-Barr, and the bone nodules, which the bone nodules are, they come from remnants of the minor salivary glands, so they are kind of, from the embryology perspective, the bone nodules, they have a salivary gland connection, and the most common is the buccal of the lingual surface of the alveolar ridge. So these are white, little ones. Usually they disappear. No treatment is indicated. So you will be a nice neighbor when the neighbor comes to your home and you say, well, this is, and you can take some pause and say a palatal cyst of the newborn. They will be so impressed. And then that's it. Just to mention something that with this we can close, and we see something, sometimes this lesion here at the hospital is the congenital, the melanotic neuroectodermal tumor of the infancy. That's a long name, melanotic neuroectodermal tumor of the infancy. In the last year, I saw maybe two or three patients here at the hospital. Now it's different because obviously I'm in a hospital. I'm not in a in private practice when probably the patients are referred here. But just one thing to remember, the melanotic neuroectodermal tumor of the infancy is a rapid grow mass located at the maxilla in a baby. Hard, rapid grow. I impressed all the pediatricians when we saw a patient with a rapid grow mass at the maxilla, and I said, well, maybe in the differential melanotic neuroectodermal tumor of the infancy, and they were, at the end, that was the diagnosis. So I wish we had more time, Dr. Berg, to go into more details.
Yeah, we will have more time, and I just wanted to thank you. You have so much expertise to share, and the audience is going to love this, and we're going to love it again when we get you back here to talk about radiology real soon. So thank you for being with us today on Pedo Teeth Talk. And thank you very much for tuning in, our audience, to Pedo Teeth Talk, where we bring you the contemporary issues important to you and your practice, brought to you by the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry. We'll see you here next time.
Do you need additional CE hours but don't have time to travel to courses? Did you attend annual session and want to listen to the audio recordings? Check out AAPD's new Education Passport. The redesigned and improved Education Passport is AAPD's online learning center, where you can earn CE and listen to audio recordings from all of our continuing education courses and more. Visit educationpassport.aapd.org for more information. For 10% off any product, use discount code TEETHTALK in the Education Passport store.
Pedo Teeth Talk is brought to you by the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, the show that delivers cutting-edge ideas for the professional specializing in pediatric dentistry. If you have any questions or comments, please email info@aapd.org. We welcome your ideas for future shows and guests. For more information on the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, visit aapd.org.